you're saying there's no Big Dipper.
No Big Dipper, no Big Dipper. I don't like Big Dipper.
How does the Big Dipper appear to us then in the sky, if there's no Big Dipper?
I've limited myself to a few constellations, and Big Dipper isn't one of them.
All right.
Here, for example, is there are three volcanoes in the Thasus region of Mars. It's the surface of Mars.
Can you show the audience which picture it is?
Yes. We're talking about this area here, and I'm putting forth some arguments that these three volcanoes are mathematically and scientifically very similar to these three stars in Orion. And we're lucky here in Southern California that we, now winter's coming, we can see the Orion constellation, and we can see these three stars. And instead of saying they're coming from 14 or so billion light years away, they're actually coming from three volcanoes on Mars.
And it's an optical illusion, then.
It's not. It's just an interpretation of the data. That from the top of a volcano, you have a lot of pressure inside these planets like Mars. As the pressure builds up, it carries the electrons to the surface of the Earth, the atmosphere, and gives you this pattern here.
Well, you know, I want to commend you, Ron, because at a time in life where theoretically you should be traveling to Las Vegas in a motorhome or playing golf or things like that, you're out here thinking about the origin of the universe and whether you're right or wrong in the long run, or need to modify. Maybe you've got some right things, maybe you've got some wrong things, maybe the total thing is right. What you're saying is you are providing what you think is proof of the pudding in this book, and let the people throw rocks or come in and say, hey, that's another way to think, you know. So I have to commend you on that.
Thank you very, very much for that, Bob.
So you realize,
this is like another page. I'm trying to take the scientific principle, and one is looking at images of the sky and what is there. And this was the three volcanoes in this. It's called the Thasus region of Mars. It doesn't matter if people don't know where it is. If they're that interested, they'll get the book right away and they'll find this. But at a different magnification, you can see those three are here. Okay, this is at a different magnification. And here is a huge volcano that's the biggest in the solar system. It's called Olympus Mons. And that would be the top star in the constellation of Orion, which is called Betelgeuse. And it's actually this whole area here is projected from Mars onto the surface of the Earth.
Well, you know, Ron, that's an interesting thought. There are no stars. I think that you have to understand, you're sort of treading on some water there that some people are going to object to, because the Bible says and talks about the stars. Or would you be saying that maybe the Bible is not correct about it? They see the illusion of lights and it really wasn't stars?
No, it's not saying the Bible says the stars, and everybody says. I'm just saying the stars have a different definition in this theory. We can see the stars and see the stars throughout history.
Well, let me see if I can summarize what I heard you say, though, is that because of the proof of what the astronauts saw as they went into outer space, they looked up and it was basically a blank sky,
yes,
instead of stars. And then you're saying you see these patterns on our planets, that look like the constellations, and so therefore that there has to be some sort of light bounce or optical type generation of an appearing star. Mm-hmm. You're not objecting to the appearing star, you're just saying, what is that really a star out there? Is it really a body in motion?
Of course it's a star, but it's not like NASA would tell you, well, they're like atomic bombs. That's what the stars up there, they say, well, what is making the light from that particular star? And they'll say, well, it's the same as the sun. But I'm saying that that light could not reach Earth from that kind of distance of so many light years and years. Stars fall light years away, and it would have the light wouldn't have reached Earth to start with. I'm just saying there's a lot of things wrong with saying the stars are suns from a long way away, and I think there's a lot of things right with saying the stars are electrons that are hitting the Earth's atmosphere, which astronomers call the celestial sphere. The lights fall on a sphere around the Earth called the celestial sphere.
Are there comets?
There are comets.
Okay. And
but the comets could actually not be objects, but more like what you call something that beams into the air. You've got light coming, and then it'll synchronize on the Earth.
Okay.
You know, it could be that kind of thing, like a searchlight, you know, at first, and then it has to synchronize with the Earth, get in line, because we need the electrons in the Earth to balance life.
Hey, Ron, what I'd like to ask you is, let's just say that this is all true, and 100% of it. How did it all begin? How did this universe, made up of the solar system, no stars, but solar system, and our planet, how did the Earth come about? How did this solar system come about?
Well, that is one of the most difficult questions all astronomers have to face.
Okay.
Because the man in the street is asking, well, how did it begin? Well, even well, Einstein even said, you can get something out of nothing. So if you split certain particles, it comes from certain particles, and you get antimatter and you get matter. You get an electron and you get a positron. The positrons are in the center, called the nucleus of the atom, and the electrons are evolving, rotating round the nucleus of the atom, and that gives you, say, hydrogen would be one of each. And then you've got helium, which is two of each. And then you build up till you get to iron, and then you get some stability and you get magnetism. Once you get magnetism, you get the foundation of all the planets. All the planets have an iron core.
Okay.
And it's like we've all done this experiment where iron filings are attracted to the iron core. So gradually you're building up the planets layers and layers, like you see in the
how grand large planning. Was the initial creation of when it first started? How much space did it occupy? Did it start real small, one atom, two atoms?
I don't know.
Okay.
Just telling you that is a possible theory
okay.
of how it came about, but
right. 'Cause we're all